when you're progressing back home, back to God. When you're progressing back to knowing God, loving God, having a relationship with God. And again, specifically when we talk about God, we don't want to be generic. We have the name, we have the information. And that Supreme Lord is Krishna. And only Krishna actually you can have. And Krishna, of course, Vishnu avatars. We can have. The Vishnu avatars are the only ones who are capable of taking us back to Godhead. You know, one of the names of Krishna is Mukunda. What is the meaning of Mukunda? Mukti pradayate, mukti pradayine iti Mukunda. One who can give us liberation from this repeated cycle of birth and death is called Mukunda. So when such responsibilities that people take, actually it automatically comes when you wear saffron. And if they are pretenders, then what is the hope of the society? What is the hope of the common masses who are ignorant, who are looking forward to guidance from these people, right? So Krishna is very strong in calling them directly pretenders. That means he's very, very unhappy with them. And on the other hand, in the next shloka, which is the previous one, now we are discussing 8. In the 7th one, he says, on the other hand, so now he's comparing the pretending sannyasis versus a honest grihastha, right? Now almost all of us are here who are honest, at least trying to be honest grihasthas, and those who are students will be future grihasthas, right? 99-98% of people or men will become grihasthas. It's only the 2% exclusive elite people, elite souls who can actually take to brahmacharya throughout. And even then, when they start at a certain point, they realize it may not be for me because of various reasons. So generally it's a grihastha, right? The society is run by grihasthas. So Krishna is comparing the pretending sannyasi with the honest grihastha who is having home, a hearth, wife, children, right? And he's saying, on the other hand, if a sincere person tries to control the active senses by the mind and begins karma yoga without attachment, he is by far superior. So Krishna has directly put that someone who's just beginning bhakti by just trying to control the senses, just trying to not be attached, right? Even at this point, there is no Krishna in the picture. It is just that this grihastha is earning something, is getting some food, is getting some money, and he is just trying to regulate his senses. He is trying to do his duties honestly, and then he is trying not to be attached to the results. So you can see that this is the first step of spirituality. What is it? Nishkama karma. Nishkama karma is the first ladder of yoga. So as you know that yoga is actually a ladder. It's multi-step process to take us back. And where does the ladder end? When you climb the yoga ladder, when you go on practicing spirituality, where do you end? Vaikuntha. That means here we can't do it. This is earth. Where does this process end? Bhakti. Prema, right? When you love Krishna, when you actually have developed that love for Krishna, then Vaikuntha is a byproduct. Actually, even beyond Vaikuntha, which is Goloka Vrindavan. You directly go there as a byproduct of bhakti. So the goal is actually not Vaikuntha, although sometimes we, to encourage all of us, we say, your goal is going back to Godhead. But I'll be honest with you, the goal is not to go back to Godhead. The goal is to love Krishna. Going back to Godhead is part of the package. Just like if a young woman, right, she marries a prince, then the palace is included in the package. She need not grow up in her life thinking, my goal in life is to somehow sleep in the palace's bedroom. Somehow. No, you don't need to think of those things, because that would be very difficult to somehow sneak into the palace, somehow sneak into the bed. No, you can't sneak in. You just, if you happen to have the good fortune of marrying the king or prince, everything is there. Everything gets automatically added. So that is the process. So now Krishna is telling in this verse, perform your prescribed duty, for doing so is better than not working. That means he's saying, be an honest grihastha, don't be a pretender sannyasi who doesn't do any work, nor easy cultivating devotional life. One cannot even maintain one's physical body without work. So, first of all, I'd like to, I kind of always forget this most important step, that I would like to take blessings of all the senior Vaishnavas assembled here. And I am sitting here only as a service to share whatever Prabhupada has given us and all the other wonderful devotees in ISKCON. And more than me instructing, actually it is me instructing myself, and it really helps. Because when I give this class, and when I go out and when I go back to my life, when I do things, for example, not think of Krishna or waste time, I remember my class. That you rascal, you told this to everyone, what are you following? So it really helps. So thank you for giving me this opportunity. So we see that basically the Karma Yoga section of Bhagavad Gita, right, up to this point, up to 3.8, is encouraging people to start Nishkama Karma. Basically Krishna is saying, do your prescribed duty, do not be attached to, what is it? Results. Okay, now let's get into the details of this, because this is where we slip. What is the meaning of not be detached to the fruits? We are all getting money, correct? And who do we use it for?
Ourselves.
Correct? So we have to understand this properly. Otherwise, we may be doing sakama karma, which is karma activities with full of desires, and maybe thinking we are devotees of Krishna. You have not even started the first step of ladder of yoga, nishkama karma. You are not even cultivating the basic detachment of not trying to be the enjoyer, right? So essentially, this is the disease that Krishna is trying to solve. Right from the word go, what is the disease we all have? We want to be the enjoyer, we want to be the controller. It's very simple. If you actually just summarize the entire material world, why people are here, what people are doing, why someone is doing something, if you want to summarize this in just two sentences, it is just here, right here. Person X is doing Y because of he wants to be enjoyer, he wants to be controller. Simple. Everyone in this world is doing whatever is doing for these two reasons. He wants to be enjoyer and he wants to be the controller. And Krishna is saying from the very beginning, try not to be the enjoyer. Be a responsible grihastha. Krishna glorifies grihasthas, actually. We all have to be happy, actually. Sometimes we feel, where did I end up? You know, what am I doing? I married with so much hope, right? Actually, today I read some famous politician's son, he married and in 6 months now he's saying, I want to divorce. Yeah. And his reason is, there is so much misery. It's better to be alone. Now, why did he end up in that? Because they never understood what is the meaning of marriage. Marriage is not, see, so there's a nice saying, love at first sight, divorce at first fight. So marriage is actually, see, there's a reason why we had culture like arranged marriages, where there were so many things that were considered, right, before putting a boy and girl together, that they used to see there has to be some kind of match. You can't have totally different personalities who have simply attracted on a bodily basis, just out of lust, you just get married and think that we will live happily ever after. It doesn't work that way, because life is not what they show out on TV. It's not all glamour. It's not only enjoyment. Life is tough. And if you have to make it work, you have to, unfortunately, I mean, I also learned all this with, you know, through the hard way, that actually marriage is nothing but sacrifice. You sacrifice for each other, you compromise, right? So unfortunately, that's not where the society is headed. So I'll give you an example. just this month, actually, there was a news report where a very young couple from Kerala, they were working in US, and they went to this in America. This happened in America. So they went to California. They shifted there. They had a lot of dreams, and this girl, she was a self-proclaimed adrenaline junkie. What is adrenaline junkie? They're married, by the way. They're from a respectable family. But once she's gone to America, right, because of association or whatever the background is, she became addicted to adventurism. Rather, I would say misadventurism. And her motto in life is that danger is good. And what they would do, they would go to different mountains and cliffs, and they would always go to the edge, right? They would go to the edge of the mountain, they would stand like this. And they would take what? What's it called? Right? That stupid thing. It's a mental disease, by the way. If you are, as they say, he's full of it. What? When somebody is a narcissistic fellow, he's only about himself. They say he's full of it. Selfie is an expression of that you are worshipping yourself. Actually, you're always, you know, they don't have any altar like this in their homes. They have photos everywhere, and they're not satisfied with taking photos themselves. They want to show it to everyone. See here, I'm happy. See, this is what I did now. And then their stupid followers will be like, wow, amazing, and thumbs up. And all this sounds good, but this leads to a kind of addiction where you get a high from that boost, right? You show off, you get a boost. That means you start developing a connection with that. It's a kind of karma. It's a lust. Lust for appreciation. And then so this lady was, unfortunately, and by the way, why I'm telling this story? So that we can learn something from this experience. So she was taking a lot of chances like this, and husband was playing to her tunes nicely. And just last year or something, she wanted a special anniversary gift, so they went on a plane very high, and she jumped from there. And she said, "I touched the sky." You know, she didn't touch the sky. Obviously, she fell from the top, right? That's all. And then this is the best marriage gift, Vishnu, and whatever they do, right? They take a lot of photos and they put it in their blog called. It's called Holidays and Happily Ever Afters. You understood this? Holidays and Happily Ever Afters. That means they were portraying that we are so happy that we are always happy and we are enjoying and like that. So people were following. And then suddenly 1 year, this lady disappeared from the websites. No updates. So people were asking, what happened? You know, where are the snow-peaked mountains? Where is that sunset photograph? Where is that river rafting photograph which you used to take, and where is that cliffhanger photographs you used to stand on the edge? Where is the photograph? We are missing you. So when you actually see, this world itself is a delusion. It's an illusion. It's a dream, actually, because as they say, we are living in two kind of dreams. One dream, we all know, right? In the night, we all dream whole night. Morning is what? Another dream. One is waking dream, one is sleeping dream. That's the difference. Unless you're waking up from the dream. What is waking up from the dream? Krishna consciousness. The more we try to realize the real soul, the nature of the soul, the the duties of the soul, which is Sanatana Dharma, the more we try to cultivate that, to that extent we are awake. And the more we are bodily conscious, the more we are in bodily activities, eating, sleeping, mating, defending, and all the others related to this, it is nothing but an illusion, because it's all false, it's temporary. Because when you die, what happened to all these activities? Gone, right? So it's an illusion. So when people dwell in illusion, they have to be frustrated and they have to get depression. So these are the two byproducts of material happiness. So there's a nice shloka that confirms this in Bhagavad Gita. So it says in 16th chapter, Krishna describes divine and demoniac natures. Very powerful chapter. When I read the chapter, I was shocked, because all the demoniac shlokas were confirming to what I was. And if you, I'm not saying you, but you can read the chapter, 16th chapter. It's very powerful. It's a wake-up call as to how actually we think we are very exalted. But when we see what is divine and what is demoniac in Krishna's eyes, actually it wakes us up. So in that, the 11th shloka, Krishna is saying, Chintam aparimeyam cha pralayantam upashritaha kamopabhoga parama etavad iti nishchitaha. So Krishna is describing who are the demoniac people. How do they think? What do they think? The demoniac people, they believe that to gratify the senses is the prime necessity of human civilization. So demons think that enjoying is the most important thing, right? And thus, until the end, their life of anxiety is immeasurable. This is Krishna's revelation. So that's why it says Bhagavad Gita is a book of revelation. If you don't read Bhagavad Gita, we'll be under the false notion that if I try to enjoy, I will get enjoyment. Actually, it's the exact opposite. The more you try to enjoy, your life will be, until the end of life, their anxiety is immeasurable. We'll be full of anxiety, frustration, and anger. So, anyway, coming back to this story that confirms this shloka. So this lady, you know what, after 1 year of absence from the blog, she mentioned why she did not update her status. In her own words, I didn't want to miss that. I'm just quoting her words. Between battling the tightening tentacles of depression and tempest of mowing madness, social media is taking a back seat. She's admitting that she's under the stringent grip of depression. So this is what happens to someone who has been showing, you know, the glamorous side of life, always smiling, enjoying, traveling, and what is the reality? This lady is full of depression. Is this an isolated case or is it a common case? It's very, very common. Do you know what? One actress in Bollywood, she admitted she has depression. Many have admitted, but one lady openly came out, Deepika Padukone. She admitted she's undergoing severe depression. And in America, Hollywood, which is the topmost of all media industry, highest paid. In India, Bollywood is famous only in India, right? But Hollywood people are famous throughout the world. But most of them end up in what they call as rehab centers. It's called rehabilitation centers. And it's very regular to keep, you keep reading in news, Charlie Sheen has checked himself into rehab for alcohol addiction, for drug addiction, for sex addiction, whatever, for depression. So this is what happens actually when you put others in depression, when you put others in illusion, you yourself go into deep illusion. And then the result is unending anxiety, worries, stress. So I'll tell you the end. This couple, right, this month when they were posing in the edge, they fell down. They fell into a deep gorge and they died. Very, very young, not even 26, 27 years old. They had so much life actually ahead that they could have utilized happily to do what Krishna is telling. Do your prescribed duties, right? Do not be attached to your results. Basically, Krishna is saying, this world, the energy in this world, right? All the energy in this world, it doesn't belong to us. It belongs to Krishna. Anybody can agree to this, correct? The food we eat, it's nothing but energy. It's Krishna's energy. We did not generate it. The sunlight, it says that Krishna, for those, of course, the impersonalists, for them, Krishna says, I am, the sun and the moon are my eyes. It's God's creation from whom we derive this energy actually to sustain our life, to live our life. So when we receive something from someone, actually that something we get belongs to that person. It doesn't belong to us. For example, anything like just a mundane example, this mobile is mine. So in case it comes to your hand, it's not yours. You can be the caretaker, but you're supposed to give it back to me. So that is the meaning of not trying to be the enjoyers. Then how do we enjoy? So that we'll see that enjoyment actually will come if we are responsible in life. So recently, I forgot which Maharaj, so somebody asked, what is the secret of happiness? So Maharaj, I forgot who it was, but very elegantly he told answer. He told, so what was the question? Maharaj, how to be happy? So Maharaj gave the answer, stop trying to be happy. Simple. That means stop trying to be happy on your own endeavor, trying to enjoy whatever you're earning, you know, by trying to buy things, by trying to go here and there, visit places. And by the way, there are many, many such incidences which I've noted down in my consciousness where the so-called charlatan travelers with happy face, they have faced deep depression. Okay, I'm telling only the latest story. So there are many, many stories like that. And these people are very famous in Instagram, which is a which shares pictures where they have millions of followers. Many people have openly come out and told after years of showing a happy face, they have come and told, actually, I'm not happy. I'm sorry, I cheated you all. Many people have admitted that. And others are yet to admit. But trust me, it's a miserable life to cheat others, because when you cheat others, the first person you cheat is yourself. So the secret of happiness, we should follow as per what Krishna tells us. I'll tell you that very simple. First mantra, stop trying to be happy. Basically, it's, see, beautiful Krishna, Srila Prabhupada's teachings, right? We are trying to be the enjoyers, we are trying to be the controllers. You just remove these two tendencies in us, in you or us. Your life will become glorious. There'll be no reason for you to stay here. That means these are the two crimes we are committing because of which we came here. And even having come here, we are committing the same crime. Then it's going to only delay and extend our stay, complicate our life, implicate our life, take us down to different species. And this birth, death, old age, disease, and then apart from all the other miseries, difficulties from others, difficulties from body, difficulties from nature, this just goes on continuing. And what is the enjoyment we ultimately do get? What is the enjoyment we get? If you take the balance in this world of what is the enjoyment you get and what is the misery you get, it is ridiculously imbalanced. I always analyze and I kind of, it's ridiculous. Like you have tons and tons of misery and you just have, you know, just a small few drops of pleasure in life. That's it. It's ridiculously imbalanced. So So we should stop trying to be happy on our own by exploiting Krishna's energy. We should start simple living and high thinking. This is a very wonderful formula Prabhupada gave to all of us. What is that formula? Let's repeat. Simple living, high thinking. Can anyone explain this? In this, the entire philosophy is compressed actually. What is simple living and what is high thinking? Okay, what is simple living? This must be simple to tell.
Only having essential things. Austerity.
Following austerity, having only essential things.
Sense control.
All are correct.
Even in our food which we are eating, we can eat simple food like chapati and dal instead of going out and eating foods, which is not good for health.
Exactly.
I can say the more of natural living.
Natural living, perfect. Even though we are in city, even though you try to be simple living, it is still complicated living. But in the complicated environment, we can try to be least complicated. But the real simple living is actually living as close to nature as possible. And what is that system? That is the Varanashrama system. We have our Prabhuji here. He can actually maybe one day give a description of the how to apply Varanashrama system. But in a very brief way, Varanashrama system is essentially identifying what, basically dividing the society into four groups based on mentality, not on birth. What are the four mentalities? There are always, irrespective of which society, there are four mentalities. And all the people in the world can fall in one of these four mentalities or little bit mixed. What are the four mentalities? Brahmana, Kshatriya, Vaishya, Shudra. Okay. Now, in the current context, somehow the Shudra thing has become something very offensive and there is a revolt going on, right? But that is all because of different reasons. But in the pure Vedic culture, the Shudras and the Shudras had their respect, they had their qualities, they had their place. They were not exploited. It is just that it is their mentality. I'll give an example. What is the mentality of a Brahmana? A Brahmana likes, naturally, his brain is very, very developed, highly refined, very cultured person. And he's not very strong physically. If you see the, even now, the remnant of this Brahmanic culture is there, very small actually. These days you can't go by who's Brahmana just by the birth or birth certificate. It is by nature, but still some traditional families, Brahmanical families, you can see actually their bodies are very frail actually. They're very delicate people. But their brains are extremely highly developed. They can think very, very advanced. They're good teachers. They're only interested in spiritual life, yajan yajan, patan patan. They teach, they're teachers. They do yajnas, they do pujas. They are capable of a lot of austerities. They are not attached to wealth actually. This is the nature of Brahmanas. You can see these people anywhere in every part of the world. Professors, big researchers, those who are engaged in research, they don't like anything but except like learning. You know, they want to engage their mind and brain. So these are Brahmanas. Then Kshatriyas, the next level is those who are administrators, those who are warriors. Though they have the natural ability and flair to control. And they are actually very courageous, right? That's Kshatriyas. Then Vaishyas. Vaishyas, they are very good in
finance.
Commerce actually. You, like some of us, not everyone can do business. But a Vaishya, he can go to any part of the world and he will flourish there because his brain naturally works like that. Then of course Shudras. What is Shudras? Labor class. What does it mean? Does it mean they have to clean toilets? No. Labors and Shudras means they just want to work under somebody. They are not capable of setting up a company. They are not capable of starting some idea or taking up an administrative job where they can rule. No, they're like, I will do something, give me some Lakshmi, give me some money, I'll go home. That's it. This is a Shudra. He wants to be just happy earning some money. He has no major aspirations in life, nor the ability to philosophically understand some deep subjects, make a lot of studies. So very naturally, when society is divided and each class performs their duty, right? It's called Varnashrama. Now when so when we are engaged in this Varnashrama, so now we cannot do this, right? Now we are what we are. We don't even know what is our Varna. We are part Shudra, part Brahmana. If you are in IT, you are automatically Shudra, unfortunately, because you are working for salary. You automatically qualify as Shudra, but there is nothing demeaning about it if you are a devotee. But if we are not, then we are in big trouble. Because whatever we do in our life, right, all the activities, they are divided into three categories. And Bhagavad Gita talks about it. What are the three categories of karma, right? The Bhagavad Gita mentions three types: karma, akarma, vikarma. What is karma? When you do your duties as per your nature. That means if you are a Shudra, you do your Shudra work. If you are a Brahmana, you do your Brahmana work. As per your nature, when you do your work, it's called karma. What is akarma? Okay, the problem with karma is what? Problem with karma is you are entitled for the reactions. If you do nicely your duty, you will get good results. But if you don't do your duties, you'll get bad result. Now, akarma is, it takes you out of this world. That means you don't get the reaction. And vikarma is, you do terrible work. You'll get lot of bad results. For example, those who are opening wine shops. Actually, it's not that you have to open wine shop. You earn your money and you visit the wine shop, you're doing vikarma. Because you are engaging in a sinful activity. Now, in Bangalore, there is a fourth category. It's called, or not Bangalore, any major city, almost everything we do is falls in the in the fourth category. It's called Ugra Karma. If you have to travel to work, you're performing Ugra Karma. That means, as Prabhupada says, terrible work. Terrible. So much struggle. So, when we are so much disturbed, how can we be Krishna conscious? How can we think of Krishna? So we have to somehow simplify our life. We have to think, even though I'm doing whatever work, whatever result comes, I need to simplify my life. So Prabhupada has given the ways to simplify our lives. So there's a nice example here. So Prabhupada was in Toronto. He was visiting Toronto temple, and in the Sunday feast program, a lot of Indians came, and so Prabhupada was addressing the Indians. So Prabhupada was telling, so now you all have come to Canada, you have traveled so far from India, and you're here to earn money, to buy a car, to buy an apartment. But Prabhupada said, but don't forget Krishna. Because Krishna is very easy to please. Because what does Krishna say? Patram pushpam padam toyam yome bhaktiya prayachati tadaham bhakti upashritam ashnami prayatatmanaha. It's very easy to please Krishna. But Prabhupada said, but if you forget Krishna, you will become cockroach in your car. If you get attached to your car, wealth, money, whatever we are attached to, right, that is what we actually get in our next life. And if we don't have the good Sukruti, then we are attached to the car, but we don't have the Sukruti, then we have to be an insect in the car. And the next car owner will do what with that insect? Smash. So it's very, so we have to actually be careful how we lead our life. So we, so Bharat Maharaj, we know the Bharat Maharaj story. So Bharat Maharaj was king of the world, and he actually, he displayed so much detachment from this world that he actually left this world and he went to the forest. He did severe devotional service and he achieved the stage of Bhava. Bhava is where you are having deep emotions for Krishna. And at that stage, he developed attachment for a deer, a small baby deer. He developed an attachment. And because of that attachment, he actually fell down. And he had to be born as a deer. Now just see, Bharat Maharaj left the whole world and still he had to be born as a deer because he developed a small attachment to a deer. So what about us? We are living in this world. We are with family, we are with friends, we are with children, we are with wealth, money, right? So we have to consciously analyze, am I detached? Am I working with detachment, or at least am I trying to be detached? And when we say you have to be detached, what it means is that don't utilize these things for your enjoyment. That is what is meant by detachment. It doesn't mean you have to throw it away. It doesn't mean you have to leave your family, leave your home. If you just try to analyze, am I trying to enjoy or am I trying to serve? You can serve your children nicely. You can serve your family nicely. You can serve your wife, father, husband, everyone. But you should be attached to Krishna. Ultimately. Ultimately. You have to develop that attachment to Krishna. Otherwise, we are deluding ourselves. So I'll conclude. So in order to live happily in this world, we have to be detached. We cannot be attached. We have to develop the detachment. There's a nice example. See, as we develop in bhakti, how do we know we are developing in bhakti? There are two parameters. The results, the fruits of bhakti is jnana and vairagya. Jnana is you will develop knowledge, and vairagya is develop natural detachment. It's natural. Even though you may be a householder, you actually internally you will be doing it as a duty actually. So we have to analyze, am I developing vairagya and jnana? And we have to be careful that you can't do it prematurely. This has to happen in a gradual way. Okay. Then simultaneous attachment to Krishna. This has to be part of your life. And how does that happen? That happens by actually doing something every day that gives you pleasure in Krishna consciousness. Now, what are the four many things? There are many things you can do. So the minimum four formula we give, A, B, C, D. One is A is for association, hearing, right? If hearing lectures or serving, taking association of devotees gives you pleasure, this is the best. This is the best attachment you can have. And this attachment removes you naturally from the, or rather detaches you from this world, even when we are living in this world. So A is association. So regularly hear. Then B is books. Read Prabhupada's books every day with attention. Not that you have to read one shloka every day. They have told in SKBC, if I don't read, then they will ask me. No, not like that. But if you're doing that, still good. But best is if you read with attention. Read, because when you're reading Prabhupada books, who's speaking to you? Directly Prabhupada is speaking to you. See, we were not there when Prabhupada was there. But still, Prabhupada is here. Prabhupada's body is here in the way of these centers, in the way of his devotees, disciples, grand disciples, and most importantly, his books and lectures. So you have to hear, and if you if you can be lost in the thought when you're hearing Prabhupada's books, when you're hearing lectures, and there are tons of places on internet you can download lectures, where there is Mayapur, daily lectures are there. You can download daily, hear one lecture. Even when you're traveling, it's okay. Best is if you can sit down and write notes, make notes. If you can't, when you're traveling, when you're in office, when the load is light, just put on your headphone, keep hearing to the lecture. If not that, hear Kirtan. We have to develop something that gives us pleasure in Krishna consciousness. That's very, very important. Otherwise, we will always go for pleasure back to the material world. We will book flights to here and there and we'll try to enjoy. Or we'll go out and eat foods, which all binds us in this karmic cycle. Because everything, this world is full of action reaction. Okay, so we'll end here. And so essentially the bottom line is anukulyasya sankalpa pratikulyasya vivarshana. So we have to analyze that whatever I do in life, is it favorable for bhakti? Is it developing bhakti in my life? So you have to analyze what is it, end of the day, not that analyze end of the life. End of the day you should analyze how much time have I spent quality time with Krishna. See, otherwise, if we don't spend quality time with Krishna, we are anyway spending quality time with Maya. The time not spent with Krishna is time spent with Maya automatically, which is already 8 hours sleep included in the package, right? Then brushing, then taking bath, then so many other activities, daily activities. We can't think of Krishna, already included. So, and then office, very difficult to think of Krishna. So almost 15, 18 hours, 20 hours goes in just basically associating with Maya. So at least few hours we should keep aside with Krishna, and we should think, did I spend any quality time with Krishna? Or did I spend quality time watching a nice movie? If you did, then we'll develop attachment to this world. Then our life will be miserable. It'll end miserable. It'll end with matlab, we'll end up being miserable. So that's what I wanted to share. Hare Krishna. So any one question if you have, otherwise we can end.
You can complete the point C and D also.
Yeah, sorry, I'm sorry. And C is of course chanting. So A is for, let's repeat, A is for association. Means coming in direct contact with devotees, or when you're home, at least hearing lectures. A. B is for books. Read Prabhupada books with attention, with the consciousness that Prabhupada is speaking to you. It's not just reading. C is chanting attentively. It's not just chanting to finish 8 rounds or 16 rounds. If you're doing that, good. But best is if you chant with attention, where every Maha Mantra you're thinking, anything you can think, dear Lord, I'm sorry I left you. Dear Lord, please accept this Maha Mantra. Dear Lord, please accept me. Anything, there are a lot of affirmations. Or you can say, dear Lord, please, every mantra you can say, please accept this. Take that mantra and place it at the Lord's feet in your mind. That is how the mind can be engaged in Krishna consciousness. So that's why this word consciousness comes in every word. Krishna consciousness. It's not Krishna activity. Otherwise, it will just be Krishna activity, but consciousness is, okay, how do I solve this problem in my office? Well, that's still not very good. So chanting with attention. So as I mentioned before, this is best done in the morning, as early as possible. And D, last, D is diet, Krishna prasad. So as we mentioned, even food is energy of Krishna. Now that food is energy of Krishna. So first you give it to Krishna. You offer that food to Krishna with love. And when you offer it with love, Krishna accepts that food. But he's so kind that he accepts the entire food and gives it back to you. And then you take it and you eat sumptuously. You become Krishnaized actually from within. From within you will become Krishnaized. Your consciousness will change. And it will become very easy to chant. It will become very easy to do the other ABC. So that is ABC. Any question? Okay, Hare Krishna, we'll end here. Srila Prabhupada ki jai.